Good evening, everybody. We're very happy that so many of you signed up for tonight. We're not surprised, though, because the guests that are here today are really, really cool. And I think this will be a wonderful opportunity for all of us to learn. So please give a huge welcome applause to Katrina Dankl, Adam Wesley-Szczyński, and Thomas Weichtner. I'm Johanna Pichelbauer, and I'll be moderating this event tonight. We'd like you to participate in this discussion, so whenever a thought crosses your mind or a question, please raise your hand, and we'll try to include you. Oh yes, and there'll be free drinks afterwards, so don't run away. This is the first event of a series called All About Design. It's organized by the Student Union of the Industrial Design Classes, ID3, and it aims at preparing us for the professional life as a designer. We all know that uni is a more or less safe environment, less safe if you think about the burning laser cutters and the super glue incidents, but I think we all agree that we have a lot of time to try out all the crazy things we're interested in. But then when we graduate and get out of there, there's suddenly a whole different set of rules and a lot of competition for us. So with this event, we'd like to give you the opportunity to listen and to learn from the ones who already made it out there. They all studied industrial design, so they've all been where we are today. They might know the struggle. And yeah, I'm just quickly gonna introduce them to you. Please correct me if I get anything wrong. There's Katrina Dankl, who many of us have already worked with. She studied industrial design at the FIUNIUM in Graz and earned a PhD from the Angewandte in 2011. Her research paper was called Very Experienced People, an Ethnography of Design, Aging and Style. She opened her own consultancy, Studio Dankl, in 2012, where she includes different areas ranging from health, food, mobility and education. Then we have invited Adam Wesley-Szczyński, a product designer, musician, carpenter from Vienna, an all-rounder. He studied industrial design here at Angewandte, actually, in Paolo Piva's class, then became leader of the design team of skiing bindings at Tirolia, and that was right after you got out of uni, right? And then he soon founded his own studio, AWS Design Team. His company focuses on sports, health, and medical equipment. And I'm sure you all know Thomas Weichtner. He was born in Brazil and grew up in Austria. He did his industrial design classes in studies in Linz and almost instantly, I think, founded his own studio. His work is positioned midway between industry and handicrafts, between mass production and one of a kinds, and has been honored with many international design awards. So maybe another applause, and then we... And then we jump right into the discussion. Actually, you might have the flyers, and also here there's, I'm not sure if you can read that, that's the question we're gonna talk about today. But we decided, when we were talking before, we decided to push the future designer topic to the end because it's more theoretical and we'd like to have a bit more time to think and discuss together. So we'll start with question two. Strategies for generating winning solutions. This question has two parts. First, strategies for how to get a project or a job. And then second, what do you do once you have that project or that job? So when we get out of uni and we want to make products and work and make a living, people might not come up to us and say, sorry, could you please design this for us? Instead, we might have to be proactive and develop our own strategies of getting involved in projects, knowing the right people, doing competitions, applying for stipendia. What are your strategies, or what were your strategies for that?
Well, I think you have to ask personally.
Okay, Adam?
I didn't have a strategy at all. That's the first thing. But I have one now. The thing is, How you get into jobs is, I mean, it's the most difficult thing. So I think the best way is if you have an anchor point where you start from, and that must be your personal one. So if you have or have gotten your personal one. So I mean, in my as you told before, and as Thomas sure knows, the first professional step into technical industrial design was a ski binding company, where I kind of really learned industrial design there. Thomas was a big help, by the way, who did this before me. And from one point you get to the next one. So I think it is important that you have your know why you want to do design, where you want to do design, and make a point on what you're doing, and there find yourself a partner to start with, a company, and from there get on. That's the
So did you already find this passion or this anchor point for yourself during your studies, or is that something that evolved afterwards?
I have so many passions. But I have the passion for technical design, not in the focus of. I love sports. I love the human body and technical stuff that wraps around it. So yes, but not in specific. And the ski bindings happened actually by accident. So it has to do with good luck, and with power yourself up, that somebody believes in you, and you first have to really make a point that you make a step into the door. But it developed most of it after the studies, but I had kind of a clue during the studies.
So your advice for the students would be to push their passions and try to find out during the time that they're studying what this anchor point might be for them.
Absolutely, yes.
And also have contact to companies already that they would be interested in working with for?
Yes. Can everybody hear me so we don't have to put... Okay, sorry. Yes, I mean, the good thing in starting here, you create your own creative network. The bad thing here is you don't have any contact to many creative companies or to producing companies. So you really have to push this yourself and to find a way in. There are two ways. One is work with other creatives to get involved into that, and the other one is to really create your own your own way of doing things, or work in a company that produces. So but this first step is it's sure the hardest, the first step, and to keep it going, because afterwards your network gets bigger and bigger, and if you do your work well and good and have the companies you do it for, so your work gets visible and spreads itself.
Katrina, do you want to go next and tell us about your strategies to get jobs, projects?
Well, I would strongly actually agree with Adam, because it's definitely the first step to find out what you're actually interested in, but I guess it's also the most difficult one. So when students ask me, usually it's the master thesis where you can choose what to do. And this is actually one project where you have half a year or a year to choose yourself, and all the other projects are mainly given by the professors or by the school. So and when they ask me, I usually respond that they should actually look back in retrospect and look at the projects that they did and try to find out what they liked most, where their heart was, or where they felt more passionate, more interested, and if they could go on with in that theme, actually. But there are many strategies on finding that out. Another one is, I think, also simply, where are you good at? So where's your most talent, and where could you actually go on with that? I know the design school Kolding in Denmark where I teach. I know the Angewandte and Graz as well. And I know that all these universities have different profiles as well. And they equip students with different skills. And I think what the Angewandte is does very well is that you have the freedom to search for your own field, that you still have the possibility to do that. For example, in Graz, where I did my education, there's hardly any time to do that. So I think you're fortunate in that point that there is some time to try things out and to already carve sort of like your field. In my own case, I was more like the looking back and also looking back to my time in Graz where I found out what was missing there. And one of the things that I missed in Graz was definitely the more theory-based research, things that I wanted to catch up, that I wanted to do more. So in my case, it was less the looking back what was best, but also what was missing. And I was then jumping into that and starting a PhD. And that, of course, also needs to fit to your own character and to your own interests. But if you're interested in that, it gives you the possibility to really go into one field very deeply and connect that to your practical work. And that, for me, opened up a lot of possibilities, I have to say, to work in interdisciplinary projects with ethnographers or many different fields, ethnologists, historians. So I did a lot of cross-disciplinary projects where my role as a designer was often to translate research into an exhibition, into a project. So that for me worked really well. And other than that, I was quite at the beginning, I was also interested in doing my own projects and get funding for it. So that was another niche that I graved out for myself, that I was putting together teams and trying to get research funding for that as well. And then being able to be less dependent on projects, on short-term projects, but to be able to work on projects for maybe 2 or 3 years as well. And both things, working a little bit in academia and doing long-term projects is how I function well. And that is also something that you have to find out, I guess, if you're good at working under time pressure or if you actually need more time to explore things and to go into fields that are maybe not paid by the industry yet. So I think it really depends. That's why I totally agree. You need to find out where you would like to position yourself and then pursue that.
And so when you came out of uni, of FH Unium, are you saying you weren't quite sure yet what your specialization could be? And is that also a reason why you went to Angewandte, back to uni, to get the PhD and also to create that niche for you?
Well, actually, I was kind of not sure what to do at all after uni. So I won a prize, a design award that was, I think I got 5,000 euro for that. And then I went traveling for half a year because I didn't know what to do, really. And I used the money for that to think. And actually, I wouldn't do that again because when you don't know what comes next, you can't really relax a lot when you go and travel. But that is as it was and as it is. But it gave me some space in between starting something new and after uni. So basically, I was confused after uni, and that's a state that is, I think, quite normal for many. And then the traveling, I was away for 6 months just traveling around, gave me some time to think, and then I went back to, I actually studied art history for a year in between, so that it doesn't seem very straightforward, but I was interested in that. And parallel to that, I thought maybe if I go into art history, why not go into design theory? That is actually nearer to my field, and maybe I can get the theory there that I'm longing for. And that's how it started. Then parallelly to enrolling for PhD, I worked as a student assistant in Postgasse design theory and started my own studio back then. And in parallel, these two started, yeah.
I'd like to talk a bit later. I'd like to talk about founding your own studio. So we can do that later. First, I'd like to know, Thomas, For you, how did that work out after uni? Did people just come up to you and wanted your stuff?
Of course. Of course, I hope so. No, it's hard to tell. Yeah, everybody is completely different. Everybody has completely different interests. But one thing I absolutely can tell, which is the difference between being successful after you study, after you finished, and being not. Because I was teaching five years on university as well, and what I recognized is that all the students have a like kind of a gap in between. It's a kind of 1 year gap after you finished starting to work or doing something else. The only thing which is important is the portfolio. It took me almost 20 years to find out that the portfolio is the only necessary thing. And to be honest, when I studied design, I was not the most talented one. I was, to be honest, not even interested in product design. But at the end, I have seen so many talented designers not being successful because of not having a perfect portfolio. So what I can recommend is a portfolio, portfolio, portfolio. This is the only thing. Whenever you have a portfolio, work on the portfolio. Keep working on the portfolio, and the portfolio should always have things not you have done in the past. The portfolio has to have things which you want to do in the future. So if you want somebody to ask you to design a chair, then at least you have to have some 3-4 chairs already done. Nobody is going to ask you to design a chair if you have in your portfolio 3 cars. So absolutely makes no sense. So whenever you do a portfolio, keep your portfolio should be the future of the things you want to do, and the rest kick out of your portfolio. This is my absolute recommendation. I have seen so many portfolios. I had been working with students on portfolios, etc. So this is the portfolio constantly describes your future, and people will come automatically and ask you for things to design. And unless your portfolio is showing your interests in the future. I started as a product designer in Linz, and the first products I made was cars, like garbage collector cars, like for Rosenbauer, firefighting equipment, and I designed lots of sport goods in that way. But this was not the things I wanted to make, actually. So one day, my wife and me, we were just on holiday over New Year's Eve in Nice, on the beach, and I said, okay, well, I was already working so many things as a product designer, and won all the design prizes, blah, blah, but this is not actually where I wanted to go. And so I quit my portfolio. I threw away all the things I had and decided to run up with a new portfolio. I made almost 10 products in a half a year with companies or without companies, and I decided to go through. If a company is with me, okay, if not, then not. And I made glasses with a Weihnachtsschmuck, Kristallkugelnhersteller, and so on. I tried to catch everything I can, and after half a year, I had a portfolio of at least 10 products, and I didn't show the products before. I never showed them again. Yeah, so portfolio.
How did you get the contacts for? You said you were doing you were making Christmas Schmuck. How did you just are people happy to work with a designer? If like, do you just talk to them and tell them that you're good and they will want to work with you, or how did you get those contacts when you had just come straight out of uni?
This is one second important thing I absolutely can recommend is when you're a designer and you make a product your own and you go to a company and show your product to the company, sometimes it works, but mainly it does not work. Yeah? It does not work that way. It's be connected only with your friends. Don't try to be connected with CEOs of big companies. And after the years, all your friends become CEOs of the companies and all your friends grow with you. So I can recommend, if you make a chair, don't go to Vitra and say, well, I'm a super designer, make my chair. It won't work because this is a different generation. These older guys working with older guys. And if you have a good chair, then go to a carpenter, which is your age, maybe 25, is just starting with a company maybe he got from his parents, and start to rise a company together with him as a couple, as a designer, as a producer, and to make new products. This is the way you get clients. Okay.
Adam, is that what you meant when you said create a network at uni? Were you talking about peers, people your age, students, or professors? I don't know.
I don't know if there's a word like yang in English. No, but I mean, there is no network here for it to get to have friends, producers. Vienna is a really, really bad city for industrial products. So you have to reach out anyway. No, I think what Thomas just said is totally, absolutely important. I think that if you, and it is also very important to get in touch with other, even other designers, but that's what you have. On Angewandt, you have this network of designers that maybe work together. You have, so I think it is, I'm not totally, I think that the portfolio is totally important, but in our field it's a little bit different. So because we still do that and love to do it, the technical stuff that Thomas quit. So it is about cooperation between companies and you, and it's not that you it's not so focused on the person. So it is, and we are three people in our studio, like the we're constantly here. So it is, and it doesn't matter if I work on, if Matthias works on, or Ewald works on it. And so it's not about the person. It is about the way we do it, and people know the way we do it, and we sell the way we do it. So it's not about pictures, but it's more about. About how we do it, and it's more about it's the next word I don't know in English, Mundpropaganda. So you get people get to know you, and people CEOs in companies talk with other CEOs in companies and said, okay, it's really nice to work with them. They really dig deep into them, deep into the projects. So you've about the cop that's how you cooperate, but the network, it's different to the network that you get here. The network you get here is you know a lot of graphic designers, you know a lot of other product designers. You have for our freelancers, I still profit from the network I have here. I created here such a lot of people, and because we taught ourselves industrial design in PIVA class by then, who was I have gray hair here and is still here, so and we didn't learn almost anything, actually. We taught ourselves how we would like to love what we think the design is. And we invited studios that teach us like you do it right now. Yeah, and that's what is the big value studying here. And to create your own way. But just the students who are strong enough can do that, and that's a sad thing.
You were just mentioning Vienna being a bad city for production, I think. Yes. Would you agree, or what do you generally think about being a designer in Vienna? Who wants to go? You want a strong opinion?
Sorry, I don't have a strong opinion about it. It depends which way to go. I think Vienna is a very good starting point. For me, it's too late for a starting point. I'm still here. But it's quite a big city, and you have low rents. You can run a studio. I was always afraid going to London because of this. I was afraid working only for my rent and could have not creative exploration anymore.
Katrina?
Vienna first, or what? Yeah. I would agree that Vienna is a good place to live. As soon as you live somewhere else, your view on Vienna gets quite focused and you see the good things about the city. So definitely a high quality of life and easy to go from A to B. And so that makes a lot of the work quite good and manageable. But I would also say that the design culture in Austria is still quite focused to crafts and to areas that are more traditional, I would say. And in that sense, if you look at other countries, again, I can bring in Denmark, for example. Denmark has a strong tradition. It was industrialized quite late, so it is strong in wood furniture design, but it has always worked always with the public sphere as well, and with hospitals, with communes, and we do a lot of collaborations there between hospitals and the design school, for example, or between elderly homes and design school and so on, or education. So I think that in that way, Austria could still open up a bit, and in that sense you need to be quite clear that you are a bit of a pioneer still, and you need to also explain why you go into these fields and have to explain yourself why you as a designer are interested in these fields. So it's a little bit, as usual, plus and minuses, but I think it's still, you have to decide yourself where you want to stay also and build up your network, because when you are self-employed, it's not quite easy to change the place. So you are sort of like also in a city then. And the jobs, things. That's okay. The job thing, I should add on that as well. Yeah, okay, I will do that. And I was not responding to the job question before, so I will quickly do that. What we did at the beginning was we worked with business incubators like Innit, for example. And what we found out there, so we started our business, our own company, by being part of one. And there were a lot of tech companies or small businesses that were interested in working together with designers. And that's where we got our first jobs. And then, as Thomas said as well, with a friend, actually. Our first job was with a good friend that went to a company, to Vorarlberg, and they needed a design for a cabin that would transport skiing guests to a skiing resort. And yeah, they asked us to compete with another company, and we got that. So it's, I think the network is definitely something very important. But what I do quite a lot, I'm not good at cold calls or doing my acquisition. I have actually never really done it. But what I prefer is to give talks or lectures or speak to, I don't know, at panel discussions when there is a special theme. And I found out that at these situations, I can more easily talk about what I'm interested at and actually this works quite fine for me, that people then recognize your name and know what you're interested at. So it's again, yeah, what is nearest to your personality, that's what you have to do, I guess. And then the other thing is that you can also create your own references. That is what we did as well, starting with small projects in an area that was maybe these small projects were together with Vienna Design Week or with a venue that gave you a platform to be seen. And after that, you would have a small reference to go to a company and to have a first, a first project to show.
This is also a reminder that you can ask questions. I'd like to move on to the second part of this first question we're talking about. But if you have anything to say or ask about what we've been discussing, then please do it now. Yeah, Dimi?
About acquisition and about finding a place. I still tend to think in the way of Bewerbung, sending a Bewerbungsmail. Yes, I would like for you, please take me, look at my portfolio and on, but at some point you said like thinking the future, maybe targeting a specific company, thinking what they would be interested and tailoring something for them and then picking up the phone and thinking like a salesperson or something like this. I mean, not thinking like the usual Bewerbungs type of guy, which is applying for a position, but a bit more different way about that.
Thank you for the question. If you wouldn't have to ask it, I would try to tell you anyway, because first, I can recommend all of you, if you send a Bewerbung, go on PDF to the button lowest resolution, because we get five applications a day, and some of them have 100 MBit or a megabyte, and this is quite crazy. So please. For the Bewerbung or for the application, the most important thing is nobody expects you to be a designer, finished designer, but everybody, the most interesting thing in application is for an intern is how you think, how you work, and seeing how the process of your working is. So it's not so much interesting how the final product looks like. It's interesting, are you able in thinking in three dimensions, working in three dimensions, what are your sketching skills, model making skills, and 3D construction skills, etc. So I think this is, for an intern, most interesting. But doing an application to a company should be completely different. So this could be absolutely focused on the company, and you should never send an application by choosing 20 companies and write in the first sentence to whom it may concern. Never make this fault. Try to focus on one or two or three companies and explain why it's interesting for you and for them to work together. And so much better to focus and to know what the company is producing and what is selling and who is working and what the process is like, and then being one of them, being involved into the topic.
I totally agree to both the first one and the second one. But also to the first one, if you make an application, you also have to, or to a design company as intern or whatever, you have to also say why you want to work exactly in this company. So you also have to kind of fit the profile. We don't get five a day. We get five a week, but still, you kind of, and we can't take them all. We can't take them actually, because that's another point. There is like way less
places for interns, then there is application. So it's I would say it's 1 to 1,000 or 1 to 100, whatever. So it's and
sometimes we have applications that say Dear Harald Gründel.
No, we didn't have that. But to the second thing is, I totally agree on that. So you have to focus on the company. If you don't have something, if you want to work with the company, and if it doesn't go the other way around, and they come to you, you have to make, and you don't have to something in your portfolio. You have to do something especially for that field. Or to, if you have some kind of similar field, it's okay. But then you have to make a design for them, even if it's not the product you will work on. If you get to a corporation, it's a teaser kind of. You have to make a teaser to tease the company to get involved, to get them involved with you.
And I think one thing that you have to add is also that it needs to be a fit between the company that you are interested on and yourself, also character-wise or personality-wise, because I see this from colleagues. Usually when you look at an office or at the studio, the employees are a bit alike in terms of personality or character, so or quite often. And I think sometimes it's simply not a good match. So. Or it might not always be that you think I would be interested, but the owner thinks maybe not, or it's a certain style that doesn't really fit to the vision of that person or to the taste of that person. So I think it's many aspects that doesn't mean anything about your work, that it's not good or not interesting, but it's simply not maybe not fitting to that special special company.
Any more questions? Otherwise, I'd like to go to part two. And that's so once you have the job, once you have the project, how do you make your clients happy? And when do you compromise? And how much of what you're doing is for fun, and how much is for survival?
I think Adam and me have probably a completely different opinion on that. I made so many faults in the past 20 years, and I learned a lot of them. One is I was doing a project for a window maker, and they give me a portfolio, and I absolutely clearly followed the portfolio. And I was absolutely thinking all the time, this briefing is absolutely senseless, but I'm doing it. And then it was the presentation, the marketing people were there, and the owner of the company were there. And he said, well, this is senseless. Why did you do it? Is it because of the briefing? And then he said, well, you're not able to think yourself. And I was so angry. It was 15 years ago, but I was so angry about it. And since that day, I never follow a briefing at all. Whenever I get the briefing, I try to work on the briefing first and make a rebriefing, because sometimes the briefing is only telling you what the company is able to think and what the company is able to do in their imagination. And sometimes the problem is completely different than the briefing, or the briefing is already having some solutions or some suggestions in it. So whenever you get the briefing, skip it, throw it away, and make a rebriefing. And the first thing you should always do at the presentation, present the briefing first. So whenever you have a presentation and you get a briefing for that, then present the original briefing you got from the company first, then the company self reflect what they wanted to have. And if the briefing is strictly, then follow the strictly briefing, but only short, and said, well, this is what you want. And now I show you what I actually think you need. So it's always the Pflicht and the Kür, but I since years, I skipped the Pflicht. I don't follow the briefing, And sometimes, I think most of the time I'm right. Sometimes I'm risking too much and they kick me out. Yeah, that's the thing.
But isn't that something that you can do once you're established? And I feel like, okay.
I recommend you just from the beginning. It has so much more opportunities for yourself. So when I get a job and I work with my wife together, we always think, is it fame or money? So this is the most important thing. If it's money, then we follow the money. If it's fame, we follow the fame. If it's none of them, we don't do it.
And where's the fun? Is the fun in fame or?
Yeah. I forgot to say. No, the project is only fun if you do it your way. If you do it just the way you think the company wants you to do it, it's not fun. And it only makes sense if it's part of your portfolio. Again, portfolio. If the project is not going to be part of your portfolio in the future, then it's senseless for you. Don't do it.
Even if it gets you money to survive and pay your bills?
That's a lot.
Okay. Any other opinions?
As Thomas said, I might have a different opinion on that. I partially do. I totally agree. There are shit briefings. You get a shit briefings. You get good briefings. But we do it. We kind of separate. If we do design work where we say, okay, the briefing's shit, we still do kind of Pflicht und Kür. So we do the musts and the wants, or the should actually. So also to get the company to think of other ways you can do it. But still, what is true that we try to work deeply together with the company and the skills and try to focus what is best for the company. And for this reason, you have to get really inside the company, dig deep, and get to know the people, get to know their skill sets, how they do it, because if you have really great ideas and it's but they simply can do them for, or they can sell them or whatever it is, yeah, it's just it falls off the table. So that's why I think it is really, you have to be you have to do this. I mean, the way we do it is we kind of try to do it with feeling. So not say we are the better ones. We think better. We know it better. But it's a thing where we first try to do it really, really in cooperation, and then think, okay, that's another thing you might consider, and very often this kind of candle that we put on the table is the thing that leads us to a second stage of the project. So we said, okay, well, it's a kind of a good start, but there we can go on with it and develop it further. The other thing is that we are in medical, we do medical equipment. So if you don't follow a briefing in a medical equipment, you just, it's just, okay, it doesn't, just simply doesn't help, which is the same with all stuff that have really, that can kind of have security stuff and medical and are tight. What we do is technical stuff that wraps around the body. It just has to fit. So there is a very much of it is a technical briefing, and the other thing which is we all sometimes we skip also the technical briefing, which and try to push it in another direction, but in kind of the if it's, yeah, some things you have to fulfill.
I would see it that way, that very often on that table where the brief is discussed, there's one decisive person not there, and that is the person that uses it afterwards. And I think that very often in your research, you're actually building up a strategy for the company, and that you do by by simply finding out where this project would fit or where that theme would fit. And that is not me sort of like coming up with that out of the blue, but it's research, it's interviews with people that would use it afterwards, with stakeholders like clinicians or whomever you that project is targeted to. And many of the projects today or that I'm interested in are not functioning by themselves. They are co-created by stakeholders that are using them. So it wouldn't make any sense if I come up with that myself, but I need to work with the people that are using that afterwards. Like if you work with food waste, for example, you can come up with a strategy yourself, but you're quite lonely with that if you don't find people that are willing to follow that strategy. And that can be the company itself, but then also the people in the district there that need to uptake that idea. And I think in that case, it only works when there is an idea and it's approached very broadly and it's worked towards with people that are actually involved in it.
Thank you. Thomas, you wanted to say something?
I absolutely agree. Medical products is a completely different topic, but I absolutely can recommend risk, 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 take a risk. I wanted to give you three examples. One was for Blaha, office furniture company. They invited several designers and architects to make up a concept for corpus furniture, office furniture. And there was a competition, and I knew afterwards that all other designers and architects were presenting already finished renderings, and completely, the work was completely done. Yeah, this was one of my most riskiest presentation. I only showed one picture, and it was a picture of a desert, and next to it, a picture of the sea. And in the picture of the desert, there was only the motorcycle, and in the picture of the sea, there was a sailing boat. And therefore, I said that in the Arabic world, they say Allah made the desert that the people have a place for thinking. And this was the main concept, that the office could be a place for thinking. And this was it. And I thought they will kick me out like crazy. And after a week, well, they said, we are going to do it. And we developed a completely furniture system on that concept. So take a risk. The other one I can tell you was a competition for in Salzburg, which was last year, for the Landesausstellung. I just did it the same way, and they really kicked me out. So I lost that job completely. But take a risk. It was now a half a year ago, there was a competition about making the torch, the Olympic torch for the Special Olympics. They were invited designers and architects to make the Olympic torch. And in the briefing, there was written only the grip of the torch. You can only design the grip of the torch. It was the briefing from USA, from the Special Olympics. And you can only make the 3D gravure on that grip. And this is it. And we agreed to take part of this competition. And then we saw the briefing and said, this is ridiculous. This is not an Olympic torch. So we decided not to follow the briefing, not at all, and to risk to have at least a good torch and something for the portfolio. But then we will lose the competition. So we did, and in the end, we won the competition. So this is, take a risk, take a risk, take a risk, as long you don't have to feed 20 people in your office.
Thank you. Any questions regarding this topic? Dimi, again. So just for the camera, in competitions, do you just go with one proposal or do you have a backup?
It depends what relationship you have with the company. If it's a company you already had made many projects and you're friends and you are familiar with that thing, then you don't risk so much. Then you know what's the next step is. But first, with that concept, you can take all the risks because you don't have anything to lose. The most thing you can lose is investing time in a presentation by doing 3D renderings, by doing mock-ups, by doing etc. And you come up and they say, sorry, this is not actually what we thought about and blah, blah, blah. Then you lose a lot of money, a lot of time, etc. So the best thing is to present something and at least having the feedback and open a discussion about what they actually really need. So having an idea, a concept, brings your partner on the other side more into a discussion as having a final product at the beginning. And then I love to make sketches. I think there's one book going around the audience. I love to make sketches. This is also a way to show things in between. So a sketch is very fast made. It gives an idea of your ideas of your imagination, of your project, but you didn't invest so much time in making models and construction and et cetera, et cetera. If you make a furniture, it's not even clear if it's wood or it's plastic or it's darkable or not. It's just a thing. So you have something to step in. Okay.
Just a question because of the risk thing. What is, if somebody asks you to work in a field where you're maybe not so experienced yet, but you're actually really interested in it, like, yeah, I just want to ask you if you can tell us about experiences in this, like, do you use it as challenges, and or how do you deal if you think maybe your skills are not so perfect there yet, but you still want to do this, and it just would fit?
Okay, maybe Adam, you could have a go, because you went into the ski binding system with them. Okay, so it was about if you would like to work in a field, but you're not very experienced in this field, you should aim for what you want to do, right? So what would your strategy be?
Yeah, you make a teaser. That's what I think that's the same thing that that Thomas first said, and I would recommend as well. So if you want to say, I don't know, I want to make a food packaging, I want to make bottles, I want to make glasses. Yeah, you first have to, you really have to do it. You have to create it into your portfolio or a presentation for a company that makes bottles, where it's for the company. So to get your step in. Still, I want to. So you have to push it in some ways. I think Thomas just said it is the way to do it. I think it's not. There's always many ways. So it is sure the best way for you, Thomas. But I think there's. I don't want. Never in my life I wanted to be famous or I wanted to be a famous designer. That's not an aim for me or I don't think for us as well. So it depends on what you really want to do, or where you want to aim, and what is the thing that makes your work special. So it doesn't have to be. A well-known Austrian designer. It can be something different as well. So even if some parts are really really alike, I think, and you really want to push all companies, I think it is. There are many different ways how to do it. So you can do it in a cooperative way. We still do different, totally different fields. But I agree more with Katharina in this thing to do it together with people and all the stakeholders, and still have put something on top that they never can do alone. So kind of if you know all this stuff, you said, okay, this is a bottle, it has a hole, it has water running out, if it's just a little. So, and that's what the company can make alone. But you make the bottle that closes it and makes it a product. So that this might be the skill, that the bottle might be the skill that the company can do. But you make the closure. So, and that's, so to focus all, that's our way. It is not a religion, it is not the only way. There's always many very, very, I think, different ways, very different fields for design, how you can do things. And design isn't a religion. It is, it is not even a discipline. There's so many ways of design that follow so different, totally different rules and approaches, and yeah.
Yeah, I noticed.
I just want to come back to the material question. I think the most important, it's part of the job for a product designer to have every time a new topic, and you're absolutely new in that field anyway. This is happened to us every day, and we have then with glass, then with porcelain, then with sanitaire ceramic, then with, I don't know, and the process is completely different, the field is completely different, the distribution of the products are completely different. And all the time I go in that company, I said, sorry, I don't have a clue, yeah? And I beg for helping me to find out what is important. So this is the thing. I found last week, I was in the Orgatech, I found a book which is called Materiology from Birkhäuser Verlag together with the Frame magazine. Go and buy that book. That's absolutely crazy. You see all the things, how it's all materials and all methods to work with that materials. It's called Materiologie.
Thanks for that tip. I mean, I'm just gonna start mixing the questions, because everything is kind of part of one story, right? But one question was called the designer skill set. And now we could talk about software and about model building and programming and sketching and all of that. But I think what I'd like to know is, what about all those things that you can't learn at uni, like self-marketing, how to price your work, accounting, production, advertisement, motivating yourself, funding your own company? Where do you learn all of that?
I don't have an answer on all these questions, but one thing that I think is above everything is persistence. So many people give up at some point, or think it's too difficult, or they don't pursue what they want to do. So I think people that do things for 10 years, for 20 years, they do have a skill that they are resilient, that they pursue something, that they know what they want to do and what they don't want to do. I think that is even maybe sometimes more important, that, you know, if you don't want to be in a company with other people, if you want to do your own stuff, I don't know, there are many, what is your workplace that you would like to have ideally? What are the colleagues that you would actually like to work with? I think there's so many questions that make working life and personal life worthwhile, and you are in a job where these two spheres very often interfere, so you can't really separate them very well. So I think these questions are really decisive. And in terms of one skill besides persistence, I would really think that being able to contextualize your work, so being able to really connect head and hand fluently, and being able to position your work in the context of what other people do, what politics are, what would you actually spend your time on, or what are you interested in doing? So I think knowing the context where you work and where your work sits within that context is, for me, quite interesting and decisive, and also in students when they do their masters. So, yeah, what is their say with that project? Why do they do it?
I think if we just saw skill set, I mean, there's the problem is that we have to have such a lot of different skills and knowledges and always be open for new skills in a second and learn almost every day. So the skill set is, I think, the skill set is learn your skill set every day new. But the thing is, sure, you have to, that the first thing is, which is really important, is that I'm not the best sketcher, but it's the most important thing for if you are into it's just a way to get things out of your head. So it is just the single thing. And sure, we have, I don't know, that's the how many different construction softwares we have used and how this is developed. So this is changing every day. But I think the most important things is to talk with people and to crystallize out what they want and what their aim is and what they can do and what is and where you just be kicked out after the job. So and have this in, if you get it in a new company, it's the most difficult thing. So crystallize their the needs, the wants, and the cans of the stakeholders, and yet, as I said, and then top that. So develop your skill set every day and connect your Halbwissen, which always is. You will never be a production specialist, you never be a marketing specialist, you never be a packaging or distribution or whatever. But you have to know it and you have to understand it and you have to really respect that. And that's what we do. We never say we are better, but say it is all you, it's the company, that's where we learn from. That's our way to do it. So always, every day. You need a new skill set. Every different project, you need a new skill set. But the first thing, the ground thing will stay the same.
What I have seen in the last years that successful designers are successful entrepreneurs. They run a company. They run a company on good costs, on good investments. Some even have some investors in the company. For example, Mark Newson, he has Brio Eisenbahn. Yeah, this company is partner of Mark Newson, invested in that studio. So it's a business, and you can only be successful in that business. First, you have to be an entrepreneur. An Unternehmer which has a plus, who works in that field. And then secondly, that's the only way to develop in a artistic way, in a cultural way, in a making sensible projects. So if I would be you today, I would ask me completely different questions. And today I thought, what is going to expect me today? And I thought to myself, which question would I ask this guy? And I written it down. So it was first, how much do you charge for design? How does a royalty contract really work? How is the acquisitions of clients? How do you protect your products or your design from copies? And what is the most dangerous thing being self-employed? And maybe how does public work or press media work really works? Because we are all three entrepreneurs, yeah? Because in product design, there are so many other possibilities not to being self-employed, yeah? So I thought, let's go on that question.
That's exactly what this is about, yeah.
Okay. Then. Okay. No, I thought I'm asking you. No. I can go through it very fast. How much do you charge for design? The biggest fault of all entrepreneurs doesn't has anything to do with design is Kostenrechnung. Yeah? Make up how much do you need to run a studio? How much do you need for computers, for rent, for insurance, for software, etc., etc. Then you know how much you need to run that company. Then ask yourself how much time do you spend working? How much time do you spend organizing? And it's almost 80% organizing, 20% working. And I have the big help of my wife. She's organizing like crazy, so I can much more focus on creativity. But making a Kostenrechnung, and this make try to find in your families an economist, some who has a clue of Kostenrechnung, or download in the internet what does it need to make a clear Kostenrechnung. Because this is the most dangerous thing. And then you know how much to charge for design. Because at the beginning of my working as a designer, I was, well, I thought, I don't know, at that time it was shilling. I thought, 3,000 shilling, oh my God, that's so much money, yeah? And now I know for 3,000 shilling, we can't survive. And so Kostenrechnung. Then royalty contract. It's because this is the big secret of all. How does a royalty contract really work, and how does it make? Go and download a royalty contract, and each company has most of the companies have a royalty contract, but try to make a living of a honorar. And then if the product runs successfully, then make a royalty contract. Maybe I can come to another time and we can really follow and we can read a royalty contract together. Then what about the acquisition? This is what I already told you, how to get clients. And I think it's being connected in your friends. So this is, I absolutely believe I know it's easy said, and I don't want to be prepotent, but I think being connected with your friends and what you're doing is not a profession, it's kind of a lifestyle. And sharing this lifestyle with your friends, time will come and the acquisition will work. I made so much default running to the CEOs, they're all in pension now. It made much more sense to work only with the friends. How do you protect your ideas? I'm finished. The protection of the I'm asking you these questions in a minute. Yeah. To protect ideas, the easiest way is not to protect them, I have to tell you, because if somebody is copying you or taking your ideas, it makes you crazy. And then and you only can work as a creative person when you have a positive thinking. Being creative, it's like a running joke on a Stammtisch. So it only works like that if somebody takes your ideas, go for the next. In the next hour, you have 20 more ideas than somebody else. Don't care about copying somebody. In my job, it only had happened 2 times, 3 times maximum, and stay easy with that. Well, in the self-employment, I wanted to tell you, and then I take over the microphone. I wanted to tell you one thing. There's one super dangerous thing being self-employed. This is taxes and insurance. So you have to pay taxes and you have to pay insurance. And the problem is, after being 3 years, 2 or 3 years,
self-employed. The Finanzamt is asking you to pay the your Versicherung and the taxes from the last 3 years and the next years ahead. So you pay taxes for 4 years and eine Nachzahlung of the social insurance also for 4 years. So this is the trap, the biggest trap, and the Sozialversicherung in Austria is the institution who is opening the most concurse, yeah? Is the biggest concurse Antragsteller. So beware of that absolutely. Whenever you own money, take at least half of the money away. It's not yours. So this is what I wanted to say. Now I ask you the questions.
Yeah, I think we'll book you for an extra session some other time.
How much do you charge for this?
Now more, because I have to pee and have to go to the toilet, so it gets more expensive. No, but we don't work for royalties at all. We just tell the client what the project will cost and he has to pay. And if he doesn't pay, we don't do the project. So that's the way we work. But I totally agree, because here in Vienna, and this is which in other cities there are like bigger creative or design companies. Here we don't have that. We don't have actually really. We're really like, I don't know, the salt in the soup, but not more. So you really have to learn how to do that, and should you learn it now? That's absolutely true. And you have to calculate your work. I mean, I had the I was self-employed before and during my studies, so I knew how to do that. So I ran a workshop where you have to, I mean designed it. Yeah, it's basically the same thing. You have to know your costs, and you have to know the worth of your the value of your design, and then you have to charge it. As it's kind of, and how long it takes you to do it, and how long you have to make a living from it. So it is kind of a basic thing, and how long it. Probably, I mean, it's for if you work long in that field, you know when the next thing is coming. So you have to, maybe there is a gap in between, whatever. So you also have to calculate that. And I would say it's the really creative work is 5%, and 95% is other things like realizing it defining it, and administration and all that, all this stuff. I didn't do it I didn't do it for 8 years, but I'm starting again. Hard thing.
How do you acquire a
company? How? Yeah, I'm actually thinking about that still. But that's the thing that we were talking about. So I'm just right now not in this second, but I'm thinking about how. Doing other stuff, doing for other companies. That's what I'm thinking. What we are not in right now. I'm not the only one thinking, but that's what we're discussing, is how we want to do it. And we actually, if this is a field that we're already in, we try to find out who's responsible. Cold calls.
Cold calls.
Cold calls is you find the people, but it's not very likely that you get. I don't know. I guess, because I didn't do it for a very, very, very long time, but to I don't know what 5% of the things that you do. So, but if you and if there's a special company, what I first said, make a teaser for them. And say, okay, that's the thing that we think the direction you should go.
So a cold call is when you don't have a project with someone, or you don't have a customer relationship or something, and you just call them and say, I have something cool for you, I have an idea, do you want to work with me? Is that how a cold call works? And does that work?
Not really, I guess, but we'll see.
I have no experience on that, but I think it doesn't really work. But what is very important, I think, but this is nearly the same, but I think was really works, when I was at the beginning of when I was doing design, I was only driven by my clients. So as you know, I made lots of ski bindings, skis. I was into that snowboard ski bindings industry deeply. And so my career was driven by my clients. So I could not decide which way to go. So, and therefore it's very necessary to react, to do something for your portfolio, to make something which is makes kind of a correction of that way. So if I don't want to be driven, or my ideas doesn't have to be driven by companies. I want to have want to steer my way my own, and therefore it's necessary in between to make completely different products, but not products like being focused on a client to call and say, well, I have a good idea. But better is to make a project which you are completely in love with, a passion project in that way.
I mean, we do passion projects also, but we actually do these passion projects also for just, sometimes it's just for years, for ourselves. And I totally agree, it is very important. To change the system once in a while.
One question. No. Did you ever protect your ideas?
Never.
Why?
I don't want to, because I think it is, you said it totally right, just for the camera. The question was, do you protect your ideas? I said no. I never did it, and I actually don't want it, because I think it is the time, kind of time to design, time to market thing. That's I don't get if I don't. It's not my problem, actually. I'm not the producer. I don't have to protect anything. It's not if the producer wants it to protect it. Yeah, it's then do it. Go for it. It's not my problem.
I'd like to move to the founding a studio business. Katrina, you founded a studio with a friend, right? After, how did that go?
Well, I founded the studio together with Lisa Hampel in 2006, and we studied together in Graz. And so we knew each other, and she was at that time working at a company in Sweden, and I started my PhD, and we were both interested in starting our own business, so that's how we started. Yeah. But we are not working together anymore. So, and I sometimes think that, for example, handicraft people, they would always start their company themselves alone, or very seldom you see an accountant, or maybe more often, start a business together. And I think that creative people tend to do that. So very often you see architects or designers starting a studio together as a pair or even more. And it needs to fit very, very well. So very often you find out that it might not be a perfect fit. And with us, we quite enjoyed working together. But at some point, my interest into going also into education and theory was more prominent as well, and I didn't want to, or we didn't, simply together we didn't want to compromise that much. So I think you need to be then open to also say, well, there's not the perfect fit, and that can happen easily, but you have to be aware of that when you start very fresh and after uni, and it's very often you don't do a contract then back then because it's all friendship and all sort of like all happy and jolly. And I think that you have to be quite, you have to think about these things because we are all, we have different characters and different plans and visions and family plans. And so you need to be aware that things can also not work in working together. But I don't regret that at all. So I think it was good. And I even enjoyed working alone now even more because I am more free and I can actually set the focus myself without compromising.
Is there a big financial risk in just founding a company with a friend or also alone? I don't even know.
So founding a company is a financial risk unless you have money. If you don't have money, it's no risk because you have nothing to lose. The best time to start your own company is right after your studies. Maybe you make some interns at companies that you see how the companies are working, and you see how the process of design is really working, because this is quite different to that what is taught on universities, of course. But at the end, I think it's a good time because you're still you don't have, most of you don't have families, you don't have kids, you don't have an expensive car, you don't have an apartment, you don't have you don't have this establishment pressure, and and this is the perfect time to start a company. So this is the best time to start a company because then you have nothing to lose. I was once a partner in an advertising agency, and we had quite we had 20 employers at that time, and I was not feeling comfortable at that time. I was less creative, much more managing, and this made me absolutely crazy. A friend of mine, he's a very good photographer, and he was running around traveling with his camera, his own, and making exhibitions all over the world, and I was absolutely jealous because he was working for himself, and I was working for 20 people and families. I didn't felt free at that time. And now our scale is much smaller, and it needs to be small, otherwise it won't work. And in that case, I absolutely can recommend this is the perfect time.
I would like to add that it's simply not for everyone. So it might be the best for you and for me and for Adam, but I think that many cannot cope with the insecurity that self-employment means, and many cannot cope that you might not know what happens in 8 months. And that can cause so many troubles or sorrows that you might not do that. So I think it's really a decision, and I want to work like that. But for me, it's a very pragmatic thing as well. You sit down at the start of a year and you plan your year, and you need to know how much do you want to earn or how much do you need to earn. And then you need to see how much revenue you have to do, actually, and in what kind of project. So in my case, I have this assistant professorship in Denmark as well, and that covers half of my living costs. And I think that this is also worth a good night's sleep, that you know, okay, this is covering something of your expenses, and you need to build your position a little bit and try to find out how much risk you can bear also and how much you feel good with. So I think it's absolutely no shame to have a second column where you stand on and sort of like make yourself a position that works for you. And in terms of, but when you want to do that, I would also not be too frightened, because it's learning by doing, and there's a lot of help also with Design Austria. You sit down with Severin Filek, and he will tell you a little bit about how it works. And we did half a year. Union is called, that's a startup for academics. It's half a year, and it gives you courses in financing, in accountantship, and so on, in business planning. And this helped actually quite a lot. There are business incubators. There's family and friends. So I think it's a lot. You need to get into that, and you learn the stuff by doing them.
Yeah, but do it before you get learn all that. I think it's important that you kind of have a clue what is our economics are all about and that you have to pay the rent. But one thing, I don't know how many of you are Austrians, but we still have a social system in Austria. And I actually still want it for all our creative people who cannot leave all the way they want from to make a living. So we still have this social system, and I hope we'll still have it next year. And so please, all of you, vote who are Austrians, which is really important that the designers, because it's really not, it's not that easy to survive and to make a company and to get your rent paid, and so you really have to work hard for that. Thank you, Thomas. yeah. So. No, but seriously, we. Ja, aber da war noch jung. No, but it's really true. So it's because it is the only risk is that you cannot make the living yourself. But in this, and if you live in these times in Austria, you will not starve, and you will get somehow your life through. You still have a family and whatever, but this is not the way you wanted it to.
I think that was a lot of practical stuff. Does anyone still have any questions about this before we move on to the future of the designer? Or designer of the future?
I hope it's okay if I talk in German after what you translate. Im Moment bekomme ich so mit, die Diskussion geht eigentlich ja um aktuelle wirtschaftliche Faktoren, also so die ganzen Berechnungen, die Prozente, wie viel man auf die Seite legen muss, etc., etc. Und ich würde gerne wissen, wie die Designer wie der Designer der Zukunft praktisch sich auf ein anderes Wirtschaftssystem einstellen könnte oder einstellen muss.
Okay, so how will the designer of the future deal with economical changes?
For me.
This is the last very important question.
Okay.
That's a very good question, and I think there can only be a long-term answer, and this is I don't know, because our society changed in the last 50 years so much, and it will change enormously, tremendously. Our society changed completely from an industrial society to a service society, and still we know that the future will be not so bright as we think, but I think there will be lots of different jobs. I think the education of design is preparing you perfectly for the future in general. Because the idea of being a designer in the future is not being a designer making nice chairs. I think the future will be on so different other places, doing interface, interaction design, making service design, focusing on systems, developing different systems, and so on. So I think there are so many opportunities with the design education, a part of the classical product design, making nice chairs. And I think that's, if I would be you in your age, I would rather concentrate and focus on what is the future, what are my possibilities for the future. In fact, the production methods and the industrialization is changing, and what is completely abstract to me is that the thinking is on one side of the world, in the Western world, in Europe and US, and the production is on the other side of the world, in Asia and India and so on. So this separation of thinking and producing at the cheapest places there's that challenge my generation had to deal with. I think in your generation, maybe this will turn differently. Maybe the production will come back to the Western world and give new opportunities in the Western world. And maybe it will not be like industrial production in Asia. So I think there are new opportunities. I don't want to repeat this industrial revolution 5.0, et cetera. But I think I would go on that, having an idea what products will be designed and produced in the future. Is this okay for you? Okay.
So I'm in this position right now that I'm finished my studies and I'm thinking about working self-employed. And actually my girlfriend and I are thinking about this. So I wanted to ask Mr. Weichner about working together with close relationships.
I have to tell you something. This is Konrad, and Konrad is working actually in our studio as an intern. And the reason why he asked this question, because he has a real role model, my wife and me working together in the studio. And now he knows all the love we have, and he knows all the discussion we have. So at the moment, we have a big discussion about the Christmas card we are going to send. And I think what also you mentioned, to have a partner working together. In that case, it's at the beginning, it's much easier to have a partner which you can share your ideas. You are much more self-confident. You have much more, you double your creativity working together. But after a while, you're grown up, you have your own partner, you live maybe a different life than your partner does. And in that case, it's also nice to work alone on your own. In the relationship with my wife, she is running the company in terms of a kaufmännische Leitung sozusagen, and we have a clear role model. So I'm doing that. No, role model is the wrong word. We have a clear separation of our things we do, and she's responsible about the financial part, and I'm responsible about the creative part. In that case, I can absolutely recommend you this. If you take a partner, then take a businessman as a partner, not a second creative. And you can't afford a businessman as a partner. You can't pay a businessman as a partner. So you have to make the businessman your real partner. You have to give him half. Half of the things you have. Well, I married my partner, but in that case, maybe it's your brother, your sister, your father, your mother. Maybe it's your partner in love. And in that case, it works. It absolutely works. And some of you, I know this on universities and same experience as I have, that designers study together design, fall in love together, and be together. There are so many designers couples probably here. So be brave enough to work together to run in a studio together and to share this design thinking, this positive creative thinking together. There's nothing better I can recommend. Do it together. With love.
I absolutely love my wife, but I would never work together with her. And I'm loving not working together with my wife, and I think it would ruin everything. And I don't work with businessmen, I just work with creatives, and it works. It's totally the other way around. So I first worked alone, and then after years, I worked together with people, with other creatives, like starting with Alexander Kufler at first, and then he developed in different directions, and now with Ewald Neuhofer and Matthias Ritschl. So whatever works is good, but we all had different the experience in advance before we studied design. So we had a different life, and then we focused on design, which is different. So we are kind of late designers, let's say. So it is, and we are still open for sharing all our creativity and pushing us to new goals and in to new directions. It's always nice for us to have somebody else that does something better. So it's always boring if you said, okay, you do your own. But this guy, he's doing great stuff. So you push yourself, which is also good. But you don't have to live together, which is also nice. And I love them. I love my wife, and I love my dear colleagues as well. Yeah, but to the design for the I was peeing and filling up water.
I would agree with that I had relationships that were designers, and it was very nice because you share a similar way of thinking and an eye for detail, and it's, of course, it can be very fulfilling, but I'm not together with a designer, and I totally like that he does something very different, and I think it's, again, different models, right, that need to work. But I think one other model is that you work on yourself, and then create partnerships that are on time for certain projects. And actually, that is what I enjoy most in the meantime. When you think somebody does really great work and you would like to do a project together, then I approach people for that.
Okay, because you said you don't listen to the briefings, and someone else said that they listen to the briefing because the medical some other designs, they need to be listened to. And I'm interested in it. How much of yourself are you putting in a design? How much design is personalized, and how much of the design is only driven by the function of it?
That's a tougher one.
I think this is super important. At least it's very important to me, because I have the feeling that some products and some ideas, I can solve it quite well, but I'm sure that so many other designers could solve it the same way. And I would do, a Feuerlöscher, yeah? I can solve it. I can make a nice Feuerlöscher, for sure. But I know that at least 20 other designers can even do it the same way, even better. So for me, it's important to have a project where I can put my idea of that product into it. And having some of my, well, it sounds pathetic, but to put something of myself into that project, some of my soul, some of my blood, some of my ideas into that, and then it's my project, and then I feel I can identify with that project, and I can show that project in my portfolio, and so on. So this is this is very important to make a project your personal project. If you still have this distance between a project and you still think of the customer and the company and the distribution and the color and blah, then it will never be your project, and then you lost time. And maybe I want to add something on working with partners and groups. It's super nice. You know it. It's very nice to make a brainstorming together in a group. Yeah, to find a concept, to find an idea. But putting this idea to the final end, it's mostly in a group, only one person or two persons who run the project to the end. And in that case, after 20 years, I'm convinced that designing is not sharing democratically ideas. It's also, it has an egoistic point. It has a point where you said, well, this is me, yeah? And it sounds stupid, but it takes a while that, and then you can discover these things in yourself.
Do you agree with this?
Partially. I think you can also work a creative together and share your ideas. I know it works, and it works well. So as everything, I mean, the three people that are sitting here have work in three totally different fields. I mean, if I just make it short, Thomas is very personally, it's focused on your person and on the things you do. And you said more or less through the products you design, you sell your person as well. So sure, you have to sell, you have to make the product your own. Otherwise, you can it's yeah. That's the way. Also, the I think interiors, tableware, stuff like this kind of works. That's how the how it's sold over the person. If it's Mark Newson, if it's Levy or Fechner or whoever. It's the person that counts. In my business, nobody gives a fuck who I am. Really, and it doesn't matter. Go back to the fire extinguisher. Sure, you do it your way, but nobody gives a fuck who designed that fire extinguisher. It doesn't matter at all. So we try to make the fire extinguisher better. Than it was, bring it and give it, and we live in a material culture, so we are we define how our times, how if we now see of movies from the 70s, we see all these products there, so we define our time, and I don't think it doesn't matter who did it. So we're just in this time, and people will see this time in the future. So. But I don't care who did it, but we have to make it special for this time, and we make I have to in we have to make it better a better product and better for the company also yeah who wants to sell it or for the employees in the company or for all the stakeholders whatever. So yeah, that's it's totally different approach. And the third, I mean, you work in a totally different field. You work in a very cooperative, a product oriented and sales oriented field. So I think sure there has to be three different positions. There have to be three different ways how do you cooperate, how you run your a studio, your business, your corporations, yeah.
I was actually going to ask it earlier, but now you just mentioned it. I wanted to ask just if you have any thoughts about the. Can you hear me? Or hello? if you have any thoughts about the rift that is kind of coming into design, I mean. The rift between you and you, between ID1 and ID2, it's kind of, I don't know if you know what's going on, but it's kind of like one is very much industry-based, one is very much solving problems and like solving the problems in the now and the solutions. But there is a trend right now in design of going into the future and like, I don't know, solving problems that aren't even there. And there's a lot of like this typical design thinking, which is a word that is very chewed out, happening. And I feel like it's going further and further apart from each other. And I was wondering if you have any thoughts on this, and also in terms of one is obviously very marketable and one is obviously not, how you see the following kind of your passion and your dreaming in a very like non-lucrative way, and how you balance that out with work, like with actual work.
I think it gets back to the question where you would like to position yourself. I wouldn't say that one or the other is the best or the worst to market yourself or to make a living out of it. It's simply a question what field suits you. And the two fields that you just mentioned, they seem to be very apart. But finally, I would say that it's also about being able to pose a question, and if you're able to do that, then you might as well find to work in education or to find a field that is not the classic or a traditional way of working as a designer. But I think that if we pose anyway the question, the job of the future, I would say that it has to go more into a direction where you have more the role of a strategic position and being able to to make that to be more on a management position, where you are actually able to make these decisions as well, where you actually influence the brief and the direction that the whole project goes. And in that sense, you could also argue that training that very, very wide field of thinking equips you perfectly for the future. So I think it's not as clear as you could actually say this is equips you well and this doesn't. It's again sort of the question, where would you like to go, and what skills are needed?
Question. So you know how Fiona Raby works, like you've been with us while she was here, and there has been criticism from, or just not criticism, but just students asking, okay, how are we going to make a living with speculative design? What's your thoughts on this? Yeah, maybe this first and then, yeah.
Well, speculative or critical design is often accused of being elitist, because it sits very often in the sphere of art as well, or it has a position in within science or within art. And I think it did a fantastic job in widening the design discipline and asking questions that have not been asked before, and positioning the designer in somewhere that is less traditional. In that sense, I think the skills that speculative and critical design has put on the table are crucial, but they need to be defined. They need to be combined with a more co-creation approach, I would say, because in that sense, it would really be the most powerful way of doing things. So I think it's more of not one way or the other. It's more a combination of skills and where you want to apply them. So yeah, I think it's a very valuable skill set, but it needs to be combined and maybe grounded. Yeah.
To answer your question, because of the separation in industrial design and, let's say, product design, this separation had happened at the beginning of the 90s or in the mid of the 90s. I was recognizing completely that this separation began. In the millennium years, it was the design explosion. It was completely, everybody was doing design, and it was also coming back to crafts and doing things, you know, one of a kinds. This is happened for the first time ever. Usually, product design was focused on making mass products in mass production for a mass of people. And suddenly the new media could possibly make it possible that you make one product for one client, for one person. So design galleries came up, and designers worked suddenly as an artist, like Ron Arad. He was one of the first who worked much more than an artist than a designer. In that case, this separation began. But what happened right now is that this separation comes back again. Nobody can see anymore the next, let's say, pastelé, the next one-off, the next idea, which is a little bit of copper, a little bit of marble combined together and somewhere. So it comes back again, and this idea of problem solving in the industrial design and the idea of making an authorship in design comes together again. So my big idols in design were always designers who were successful in both fields, who had the possibility to work in two completely different fields. Ettore Sozzo is a very good example. He was working in Olivetti and was working in this completely office field on one hand, and making a shelf which was produced 5 times and went all over the world in the 80s. So this is, and the second thing of the separation of these two fields in the industrial design and product design was always, or is always, the everything which is behind the stage. The money you pay a design agency is one fee. The money you pay a designer making a chair is a license contract. The media press work you make as a design company is making a design agency attractive to companies. As you do it as in a field of a one-off designer, it's also the person who is doing it very important. So and suddenly also some designers have one-offs which are in the mechanism of art industry. So it's only sold in galleries and is following completely the art business, which is a completely different business like a design agency is working. So this differentiation is going, is different, but I am absolutely sure it's coming back together again. Don't miss the other side. And one thing I wanted to say to you in the back, you asked me about the future in design. There's one thing which came up in my mind. When I was in your age, there were only a few very famous Italian designers with a good PR agency. And sometimes in design history, I was asking myself, oh my God, what is this product is kind of senseless in design history as it stands. I remember skating shoes from Hartmut Essling. He was in far in the 90s, it was always in the design history books. And I said, oh my God, why? And now the media and the internet changed it so much that somebody in a small village in Kazakhstan can have a nice idea, can realize the idea and send this idea around the globe. And within 48 hours, the idea is published, developed, and somebody is grabbing it up, developing it further, and so on. So good ideas will spread, and not pink roller skaters will spread. So the design history will have, in 100 years, we will see that the internet made a complete break in between, and only good ideas will survive.
It does seem like there is a big shift happening at the moment. If we look at ownership, and many people question the accumulation of more and more goods, they want to share, they want to live without all the things they might not need. And I mean, we've talked about motivations behind your jobs. And I don't know, it might be a bit unfair, but you said money and fame. Where's the social responsibility and the environmental responsibility?
Yeah, Because money and fame, it's not money and fame at all. It's also, of course, it's a social responsibility in between. So, but the social responsibility is part of the design job. Like sustainability is part of design job. No designer is developing a product to harm people. So it's always a part of it. We do. We just made a project with the Caritas together, and we developed candle holders. But we don't even design the product, the final product. We tried to design the process of making the product. So it was not. We designed the tools. How to make the product because the clients are completely different in this working process. I think it's self-understanding that social responsibility is part of the job.
Would you like to add something, or do you want an extra question? I have an extra question actually. So. For your design, innovation and the kind of inventive genius seems to be a driver. Well, I don't know. I mean, if you look at technical solutions for problems in health and sports. Yeah, inventive.
Yeah.
Might have been the wrong word. Erfindergeist. What does a pioneer do differently to be this extra bit ahead of everyone else?
Yeah, sure. My mind is still in some other different field about social responsibility. It's kind of hard to switch. But a pioneer, if you do new stuff, if companies have departments for innovations, R&D departments that try to be ahead of their competitors. So it's basically the job of companies that you want to support. That that to do something new with and in part also companies, startups and entrepreneurs come to us. They often have the problem that they just have no, like us when we start a company, we have problems of knowing not all everything of the other fields. So they often just know one solution for one thing and not the whole rest of sales and whatever and distribution, which comes to their mind. So they are in starting companies have here in Austria, where you don't have this kind of in the energy of our society. If they don't make real small scale production like handicraft stuff, they sometimes having a problem getting started. So that's why we kind of first ask them kind of a list if they thought it all through. I mean, this kind of comes kind of off the question, but it is very important that you if somebody approaches you that says, okay, I have this wonderful idea, it's better than everything else, you said, okay, you want to know if it's a great idea, if it is a great idea, but because sometimes it's not even a good idea, or if it makes the market, you always have to you reinvent. It doesn't in the technical field, it doesn't help if you once make a facelift and the second time nobody cares. You still have to invent something new to make it fit better to our society, to the I don't know if it's in health to help the people better, to in sports to make it better performing, whatever. So yeah, there's always a development that you have to. It is a need. There is no not doing it. But just to the social responsibility, I think we actually
we produce everybody who's in the production field, we all do product spam. And we have to respect it and live with it. That's what we do. If we say it is sustainable, it is not. If it would be sustainable, it would not work. It is just it's that simple. We don't do we can sit on I don't know on whatever. We don't need it. We don't need a new TV. We don't just need it. People want it. Our society lives it. Our social system works on that. Our taxes, whatever. That's how our society works. So it is not the good world. We make it ourselves to say, okay, it's a wonderful world, but it is if we make products, we do spam. Even if it's nice spam.
Yeah, I think we're almost out of time.
Okay.
I would just like to nuance that a little bit. If you look into material culture studies, for example, Daniel Miller, he wrote the Trost der Dinge, the comfort of things, where he went into a London street and knocked on every door and asked questions about the relationship between objects and people. And he actually made the point that those people that had a love for objects, they were usually related to people. So it was also saying about something about their relationships and about gifts and about how they live their life. So I think that we do have an affection for things. They don't always need, I agree, to be the newest. And we are ultimately that what Papanek said 40 years ago, that we are the second worst after advertising. I think it's hard to change that. I mean, but we all have read things for the real world, and we know that. So everyone has to deal with that and cope with that and carve out a niche where he or she can live with it and be comfortable enough. And basically, I think that very often this time it doesn't need to be a product because simply this is not the solution for the problem that has been posed, or you're actually defining what the problem even is. And even if the briefing says it's this and that product, it might be in a project that is more open that you actually find out that it's not. And I'm more interested in these projects where you have the freedom, where you have to can actually decide what the problem is, if you want to use that word, and how you would like to respond to that. So it's, yeah.
Thanks. Anna, do we still have time for a last round of advice or not? Just 5 minutes. Do we have 5 minutes?
Yes.
Okay. Maybe as a wrap up, every one of you could give us one short advice that would have helped you very much when you were in our situation. So just finishing uni, on the edge to professional life as a designer. One short. Okay. Or not? I mean.
One big advice. Is there any question? Please.
Hello. We were mostly talking today about smaller to medium scale companies, and I actually have a question about bigger scale companies. I don't have much experience, so my question might be not relevant. Bigger companies get to design bigger things. For example, I don't know, if I want to design spaceship or be part of designing, I've heard terrible stories about people who go to internship and they become closed in a loop where they have to day by day check polylines for solidity and whether they can hatch it or not, and they are not actually involved into designing spaceships. So is there any way to get there without spending 7 years doing non-relevant job, or how do?
Actually, working for bigger companies is the most beautiful work you can make, because all your partners are professionals. This I like absolutely the most, working with bigger companies. There, for each job, somebody is responsible. And for each project, somebody is responsible. I'm just working on a collection for Swarovski. It will come on the market from 2017, 2018, 2019. And at the beginning, I thought this is kitsch bling bling. At the end, I found out this is super professional and it has much more to do with industrial design than anything else, because the products are produced in a super high scale, and there is packaging, transportation, all the making of the product, where is it made, who made it, and so on. It's so it has I really enjoy the collaboration with this company, because it's a big company. Yeah? But the difference between handcraft and a big company, industrial company, is often not what it is. A spaceship, for example, is a handcraft product. It's only made a few times. It's a five-time project. So this is everything on a spaceship is handmade. And on the other side, I know jewelerists, for example, who work in a very automotive way, which work with computers, with rapid prototyping, and work in a very scientific way, and artificial way. So this sometimes it has nothing to do with handcraft anymore, watching the jewelerists making jewelry. So the borders are completely shifting at the moment. For example, I made firefighting cars. So this is a handmade product. This is each of this product is handmade after each other. And sometimes a drinking glass could be a super industrial product which is made in a tenth of a second. Yeah. So never charge a book by its cover. Yeah. So sometimes in behind that company, there's a completely different process. A T-shirt from H&M is a handmade product. Somebody was there at the sewing machine and sewing this shirt. It's not industrial product. Yeah.
We made just to a size of companies. So every size of companies has its own way it functions and its own market and how well to do it. But to kind of summarize our experience, there are the really big companies like say with Bosch Siemens, for example, which are like really huge. And there are medium scale companies. There are like just a few hundred or thousand people, which are, in our opinion, they make big scale products, they make hundreds of thousands of pieces, but everybody, the communication works quite well in these companies. In the bigger ones, they have production there, engineering there, some design department here, some marketing's over there in totally different countries. That's same with other this scale companies, and which makes projects really long. Really long, expensive for them because they have to pay us all, and their communication, and for us enduring, because working 2 years on a product and redoing it, making details again, and not having the energy to drive it at once is still we love to do it. But you kind of have to relax yourself and say, okay, the next step is, I don't know, half a year away. And then the communication comes back to you, things change a lot, and you do it all over again. And you don't go to the people, come on, let's sit on the table, we discuss it, which is in medium scale companies quite easy. So you have responsibility, but you have communication between the responsibilities in our experience, which is if it's a handcraft product, sure, you have other problems and you have a direct responsibility, and it's kind of, yeah, also very different to work together with them.
I think a totally different field is then the public sector. If you think of a hospital, then again, it's a different scale. And very often you have to be aware that you can do something locally. And it's usually somebody that would like that is behind that. Like in Denmark, it's a, they established a center for shared decision making in an oncology hospital, and it's usually a clinician that is actually heading that idea and is working with patients and with doctors and with nurses and relatives and the cancer society and so on. So you have to, you actually have many, many different people in front of you that are your actors and your people to talk with. And then again, it's on a national level that healthcare systems are simply made nationally, so they are not made locally in that hospital. So you also need to be aware that this is a, let's say, this wicked problem that Horst Rittel and Weber talked about many, many years ago. It's totally complex and intertwined, and yeah, you also have to be aware that you. Yeah, you can create something, but this is not a traditional product that you create, and you have to be aware of the limits of design as well. Yeah.
Beautiful last words, to be aware of the limits. I would say there were still some questions, but are you going to leave straight away? Or, I mean, we're still having drinks. Maybe you could just ask the questions personally, and we leave it here. So thank you very, very, very much for coming. And we might just have you again sometime in our, at our studio or something for breakfast. That'd be nice. Thank you.